The following program is brought to you by TZ Productions, offering 40 years of media experience.
Brought to you by Central Security Group, your experts in home automation, security, and peace of mind. View video on your smartphone and control your home's lights, locks, heating, cooling, and more. Security app compatible with Apple Watch and Amazon Echo. Welcome to Positively Kansas. I'm your host, Sierra Scott. This is a show where we focus on people, places, and ideas that make our state the best it can be. Kansas is the second windiest state in the nation, and we're taking advantage of it. About a quarter of our state's electricity now comes from the wind. As wind generation continues to grow, Kansas could become a major energy exporter, creating thousands of jobs and pumping billions of dollars into the state's economy. You've seen the large industrial wind farms that dot the countryside, but have you ever seen one like this? Jim Grayway has the story.
Cruising along Highway 77 in Marion County, it's hard to miss. Take a closer look and you'll see what's going on here. The sun is reflecting off the steel blades of Roger Nirenberg's wind turbines.
I have more people that enjoy going by and seeing the flash in the sun, and more people will visit with me about those sparkles. They call them sparkling.
Nirenberg, who runs a heating and air company, designed and built these turbines from the ground up with parts he knows well. The rotor blades are actually air conditioning fans, but instead of creating wind, Nirenberg is using them to catch it. And the generators? Those are air conditioner motors he has modified and reversed, so now they create electricity.
Rain doesn't affect them, snow doesn't affect them, an ice storm. The only thing that would affect them, lack of wind. In this county, we don't have a lack of wind.
Nirenberg says his biggest expense is erecting the poles and installing the battery bank that stores all the juice.
I can take my meter and I can see on this wind day what kind of volts, AC volts and DC volts we're getting. So you can see it fluctuating, that's DC volts. That's what's going to go to your battery. I could run the entire farm if I wanted to, but right now I'm just going to run the barn and my greenhouses. It will heat water, it'll run all the lighting, it will run my machines in the barn, my drills, my presses, and so forth. The satisfaction I get is dealing with machines. I happen to love machines and I like science.
And he likes thinking that maybe there's a good cause here to tout.
It makes you feel good that you're doing something you aren't consuming. I don't have to consume fossil fuel.
But for Nirenberg, it's not political and he's not trying to be trendy. He's just using good old Kansas know-how and common sense to put our abundant wind to good use.
I'm a libertarian. I believe in very little government control. Well, you'd think a conservative person wouldn't be for this. You'd think we would stay with fossil fuels. And that just is not the case. Just because you're conservative don't mean you can't change.
Nirenberg says he enjoys showing off his wind farm to curious passersby who spot it from the road. It's located right along Highway 77 near the Marion County Lake exit. You can't miss those shimmering blades spinning on a sunny day.
I'm here with Tim Devlin, a very good friend. And I tell you what, Tim, you have done so much in this community. He's also with Devlin Rod and Customs, owner of that. And also, are you the organizer of the Starboard Devlin Car Show, or what would you call yourself?
I'm actually the board president of the organization that puts on the show.
Excellent. And it is an excellent show.
Thank you.
And we're going to talk about that here in just a second. But you brought in some amazing cars. We were talking earlier about the fact that cars bring out something in people. There's an emotional attachment. They'll talk about the history of the car. You've got one really interesting. This is one that isn't normally seen much in the mm-hmm. United States.
Yeah, this is a 1962 Mercury Meteor. And in the early 60s, Ford and Mercury decided to bring a Marquee from Canada down to the U.S., and unfortunately it just wasn't very successful, so it had a three-year run, and then that was the end of it. So we don't see a lot of the Meteors. We see a lot of the Fairlanes, which was their kind of in-house competition, and it was just a cheaper brand for them to buy the Fords than it was the Mercurys.
Now, you restored this yourself, correct?
My shop. Devlin Rodden Customs built this car, absolutely.
Okay. Talk about what it takes to restore and maybe some of the things that you did during the restoration process.
Well, you know, this car, actually, we kind of got lucky on this one. This one was a 36,000-mile original car when we got it. Now, it still needed work. And what we talk about when we build a car is we take it and build a ground-up build, which means every nut and bolt, every component on the car gets either refinished, replaced, or something else happens. So that takes a lot of time. We're talking about a year to build a car or longer sometimes. And so when we start seeing things like rust and bad components, all of that gets replaced. And so it is a lengthy process. There's a lot that goes into it, and a lot of people that have their hands on this at a shop like ours.
See, I love that, and I think it's so important to restore parts of America. This is just our history, and it means so much. Talk about, you were saying it's a lengthy process. So how long would it take to restore a car to this level? I mean, it's beautiful.
This car we built in about a year. When I found the car, it actually came out of Kentucky. And probably the worst parts about this car were actually what was found underneath the paint from about this level down, mainly in the floors. There was rust. That's an area where there's a lot of humidity down in Kentucky, and so this car had some rust and issues like that, but everything was there. That's a nice thing when you start with a project car. A lot of times people think, oh, let me find the cheapest thing I can find. Well, it's missing parts, it's half gone, and all that. With this car, everything was there, so we didn't have to go out and search for a lot of parts, which is nice.
That makes it much easier. You've got another gorgeous car mm-hmm. here. Tell me a little bit about this one, too.
This is a 1957 Ford Fairlane 500. And this is what Ford had to compete against Chevrolet's Bel Airs. And this car is, you know, from the onset, it's using factory colors, but it has been customized to a certain degree. It's got different door handles off of a T-Bird. It's got French headlights and taillights. It's got an original 312 Y-block, which would have come in the car, but it's been modified. It's been upgraded for more performance. It's also got a 4-speed manual transmission that also didn't come in the car. So, you know, it's got some fun things. We also like to do things to upgrade these cars to make them safe. Both of these cars have been upgraded with disc brakes up front, so that when we get out on these streets, we can stop with every other car that's out there. So we do a lot of things like that besides just making them look nice.
When you take a car like this and you make those changes, does it change the value of the car overall?
You know, it can. It used to be that the mindset 20, 25 years ago, if you took a car and turned it into a hot rod or a custom, you devalued the car. Well, times have changed, and now we get into where people want more of the hot rods, or they want to take an original car and do those upgrades like we talked about, disc brakes, air conditioning, seat belts to make them safe and more comfortable. Now, if you were to say, oh, let me take a really rare car and start doing these things to it, then yes, you are going to devalue that car. But when we start talking about cars like these two, it's really not going to hurt anything. Now, it may not be worth what we've got in them, but we're not devaluing the cars.
Exactly. Well, one of the things that I really love about the Starboard Devlin Car Show is you see cars that you don't see anywhere else. How do you track down some of these cars? Because sometimes they haven't even been seen in the state, entire state of Kansas.
That's right. And what we have is our Magnificent Seven program. And what that is the cars that are entered into the Magnificent Seven are the first time they've ever been shown in the Wichita and surrounding areas. So by virtue of that, we've got cars that haven't been seen by Wichitans. Then how we get those cars is we've got individuals throughout the United States and our region that go out to various car shows and events and go out and personally invite these cars to come to our show in January. And so they work very hard all year round going to these car shows, inviting cars and getting them to come to Wichita in the middle of January, which isn't always an easy sell.
I would think not. But I will tell you, I love that car show because I love to go every year just to see what's new and different and unique and something I haven't seen before.
Absolutely.
And for people who are watching right now, it's always in the middle of January, mm-hmm. so be sure to check it out.
Absolutely.
Always going to be at Century 2?
At Century 2.
Okay. Well, thank you, Tim. I really appreciate your time, and thank you for bringing such beautiful automobiles.
You want to do our Washington Lee swing?
At the Hillsboro Senior Center, the twice-a-month concerts are a big draw. People gather to enjoy the songs they grew up with, performed by a group of passionate and experienced musicians. most experienced by far is Bob Delk.
I just enjoy music.
He doesn't necessarily look it, but even among this group of seasoned citizens, Bob is the grown-up in the room.
I don't think about my age. I just want to do what I want to do.
He's pushing 95 and still tearing it up.
And I'll play with anyone who wants to play together with me, I'll play with them.
Bob caught the music bug when he was 10. It ran in the family.
My dad played a fiddle and I played the banjo, and my mother played what they call a dobro now, and my sister played the piano.
His partner for the past 60 years has been Eugene Just. He is just a kid of 78.
Most of the time I was the kid in the group, yeah. I always introduced Bob as my grandfather, but really he wasn't. But he always has been older than me.
We found them practicing together at the Methodist Church in Olney. Eugene is not a part of the group at the Senior Center, but he and Bob play other gigs together and have been bandmates since the days of the Peabody Plainsmen.
We were Grand Ole Opry's wannabes.
I played acoustical guitar for a while, but they hardly have any sound to them. You have to play through a microphone, and way back then they didn't really have many microphones, so that's why I played a banjo. You could hear that in a group. And then later when electric came out, I started playing electric, and I enjoyed it.
Well, this is an album that we made with the Singspirational Quartet. Bob was playing with us back then, and that was done in the mid-70s, I would guess. You can tell the vintage by the go-go boots and the white shoes and the crew cuts and that type of thing.
They both say gospel music is their favorite, but classic country is a close second.
We enjoy music and we have a lot of fun with it. If someone said you're only as old as you feel or think, you know, and well, I don't know, I don't want to think about my years. I just want to keep it going along the Lord lets me live. I enjoy life, I enjoy meeting people, and I enjoy music.
Hey, good looking.
Yeah.
Okay. G.
Hey, good looking.
He becomes a role model, an inspiration for me to keep going so that I don't turn into a prune when I turn 75.
Around here, if you want to have a fundraiser and you want it to be successful, you want the folks to come out, you just ask Bob to be part of the group.
Bob and the boys.
And whether it's Bob and the boys, or whether way back it was the Peabody Plainsmen or any of the other groups he played with, then it was a success. It just adds brightness to my day. I can be feeling a little bit down, and I start hearing Bob play, and it just lifts my spirits. And I can be feeling up, and it just raises them higher.
Bob has inspired several of his grandkids and great-grandkids to become musicians. They see that it truly is a talent you can enjoy your entire life. Not to knock sports, but you're not going to be playing football when you're 95.
One place you have to eat, we're standing right in front of it, at Pizzacos. It's a pizza taco kind of mashup.
Oh, Ken's Pizza.
The Anchor.
Anchor.
Why?
Because it's the best Mexican food you can get around.
Best Mexican food around. Can get a better deal, better price, better food.
What's the one tourist destination I need to see?
The salt mine or the Cosmosphere?
Probably the Cosmosphere, because it's different. There's nothing like it.
The Cosmosphere. I grew up going there my whole life, and people don't know what we have here in Hutchinson. It's awesome.
Well, the Cosmosphere is a must, of course, if you're here during the fair. But just downtown is a great spot.
What one shop do we need to
visit? Well, a million. Sonia Bedelia's, of course.
I own a shop across the street, Nicholas Jewelry and Design. We get visitors from Oklahoma, from Wichita, from Kansas City, just to come shop downtown. That's a hidden gem for sure.
I'm a visual artist from Chile. I came here in 2005 to the States. A lot of my work deals with labor and social issues that I have personally struggled with. My language is making art. So looking at the news and looking at like cultural development is what really motivates me to point at things, point at problems, or point at solutions. So in this case, I'm showing here is the Prole. It's a work about the disappearance of the labor union movement in contemporary society. So I think it's the only way that we can keep a government and organizations and corporations accountable is by having a strong labor unions. In the show here, all the canvases are the same size. They're all the drop cloth that you use for painting. And I have done these stencils based on labor union symbols. It's a labor union symbol that I erase the words and any other way to identify the particular labor union. And once you remove the letters, you start noticing that these symbols start looking more like a soccer team or like a military symbol. And that helped me to remark on this capacity that we all have that like wanted to find brotherhood or wanted to find sisterhood, wanted to find this, you know. So in some way, what it used to be labor unions, for my father generation, now it's really either the military or the sport teams. Within the making of the work, I try to remark on the fading qualities of the labor unions themselves, you know. I consider myself a cultural worker and just try to make visual gestures to empower society. You know, I think like we all should try to make society better in whatever capacity we can. And just my language happened to be art, or visual art.
Wichita was once home to two of the most spectacular theaters west of the Mississippi. KPTS recently chronicled the stories of the Miller and the Orpheum in a documentary, Lost Theaters of Wichita. Efforts to restore the Orpheum continue to move along, as do efforts to restore theaters in smaller towns, where many of the local movie houses have fallen on hard times. Adam Knapp takes us to Cali County, where volunteers have been working hard to bring two downtown theaters back to life.
One thing about historic movie houses in downtown, they're not making any more of them. Two cities in Cali County know that better than anybody. One of them's already a success story worthy of a marquee. The other still faces an uphill battle.
The 1,200-seat Burford Theater opened in downtown Arkansas City on September 15, 1924. Arksidians knew right away they had something special.
During that time, there was an actress by the name of Colleen Moore who had done probably 40 or 50 movies. And opening night was Colleen Moore and the Perfect Flapper. And she sent signed autographs, and everybody was really excited about this wonderful theater that has so many historic and architectural secrets.
But the years went on, times changed, and the Burford went through a series of owners. And by the 1990s, it was facing hard times. The Burford was in poor condition, and it became an afterthought when more multiplexes started popping up. B&B Theaters opened one right up the road near Strother Field in the mid-2000s and donated the Burford Theater to the Arts Council in Ark City. After a feasibility study, it was decided there was enough support in the community to restore the Burford, but there was a lot of work to be done.
If you go back to the beginning of it, it was simply trying to get a great deal of work done by volunteers, people who had no particular training in what we were trying to do. But the original, probably 5 years, and we worked basically Saturday mornings, and that was simply taking out literally hundreds of tons of plaster and false ceilings and old flooring and one thing another.
More than a decade later, it's almost a $10 million project. It was helped by grants, since the Burford is now registered as a historical site. But most of the restoration is because of private donations and thousands of hours of volunteer work.
It's important to Ark City because it's a very central focal point of downtown. Plus, it's a piece of history.
In 2016, the Burford marked its grand reopening with five straight nights of celebrations. There were costumes from the Roaring Twenties. There was a speakeasy soiree with bathtub gin. There was an open house and performances by Music Theater Wichita.
It was a thematic thing, and everybody was dressed, and we were so lucky because we had our own private ghost that evening. I don't know what happened, but the lights went up, and the lights went down, and the lights went up, and they went down.
Still waiting for its premiere party is the Marquee Performing Arts Center, right up the road in downtown Winfield.
We're getting there. It's just going to take time.
Opened in 1950, the Marquee isn't yet recognized as a historical site. But it belongs to Winfield, as B&B donated the Marquee, just as Ark City had received the Burford. The Marquee sat empty for a couple of years. It has since restored the retro 1950s look to its lobby, but the theater itself has been gutted. No seats, no digital projector, just a makeshift movie screen and lots of concrete.
Personally, I'd like to be able to bring my grandkids to a movie, a first-run movie that was done 30, 40 years ago, right here, you know? Why not?
More time, more money, and more work needed to preserve one of the hidden jewels of Kansas. In Cali County, I'm Adam Knapp for Positively Kansas.
He had decades-old negatives finally developed, but what this Stafford County man found came even as a surprise to him.
And it's just an incredible collection of photographic memorabilia.
85-year-old Marion Hearn has spent the last 9 years of his life working on a project that may be one of the most complete collections ever restored.
So over this time, when you first started this project, did you ever expect you would be doing it for 9 years?
Heavens, no. Might not have started it if I had of.
This is believed to be the largest collection of glass plate negatives that focuses on one specific geographic area. The photos were taken by a man named W.R. Gray, who operated a photography studio in this small Stafford County town.
He worked at St. John from 1905 until his death in 1947.
Nearly 40 years later, W.R.'s daughter Jessie donated her father's life's work to the Stafford County Museum.
We were given all the negatives, about 30,000 of them.
30,843 of them, to be exact.
That's a lot of stuff.
The project was such a huge undertaking that the museum wasn't even sure where or even how to start. So the glass plate negatives would sit in a basement storage area for another 21 years.
Well, the glass negatives project started it in 2007, but we got the negatives from the W.R. Gray Studio in 1986.
In 2007, the museum contacted the Humanities Council, which told them how to find grants to help cover part of what came out to be a $25,000 cost. But more importantly...
And they sent a consultant that came and showed us exactly what to do, how to clean the negatives and catalog them and preserve them in archival envelopes and boxes. And so on October 20th of 2007, we just started doing that. And just one by one, over the last 9 years with my volunteers, they got it done.
Marion Hearn was one of those volunteers. He spent anywhere from 4 to 8 hours a day, every single day, cleaning and restoring these historical plates.
And I had cleaned and had a number of negatives. I've cleaned 17,043 negatives that I've cleaned. And that has taken me 1,977 hours. But then that's been 9 years ago when we started.
And it was quite a labor of love. Some could take as long as a couple of hours to restore.
We brush them with an anti-magnetic brush, and then we wash one side with a cotton ball dipped in distilled water. And then after that dries, and we get information that goes on the envelope, why then we put them in acid-free envelopes. Then they are put in acid-free boxes. Some negatives go a lot faster. I have done 65 in a day and maybe only 20.
But when we first started, we thought they would just be studio shots of people.
But it was so much more.
You know, there's pictures of houses and cars and clothes and just all sorts of different cultural things. We found pictures of town events, town buildings and insides of buildings, outsides of buildings. Mr. Gray took mugshots for the sheriff. He took pictures of crime scenes for the sheriff and the police. And then there were also pictures of schools and churches, clubs. I mean, just anything you could imagine in town. Well, I think that it's important because with such a complete collection of negatives from a photographer in one town, it contains the whole history of the town, more or less. It's just a complete photographic history of the people and the places and the events of the town.
What makes this collection even more valuable is the fact that these negatives came with matching records.
We do have some identification for the pictures because Mr. Gray left ledgers behind and he numbered all the pictures.
11 ledgers in all.
So we have the date and the name of the person who paid for the picture, which is usually a family member of who it was. So that's what makes the collection really valuable.
The fact that each picture was listed with the date it was taken helped museum curator Michael Hathaway match them to newspaper articles or other publications where they could be identified. Never in his wildest dreams, while meticulously restoring these negatives, did Marion think those records would touch his life too. Each time Marion finished restoring a glass plate, he would give it a new number and a short description of what the picture was.
I identified that as two little boys sitting on a stool.
But it was a lot more than that.
Well, when I go over to the ledger that Mr. Gray has filled out, it said Sylvester Hearn, that was my father, twins, Marion and Melvin, 4 months old. Certainly a surprise when I run across, found my own negative and didn't know it.
That's so cool. I can't imagine. So when you finally figure out that is you, what was the first thought that went through your head?
Oh my, oh my goodness.
On November 9th of 2016, Marion restored negative number 30,843, the final glass negative in W.R. Gray's collection.
How did you feel when the last one was done?
It was, what am I going to do next?
If you know someone in the photos or just want to check them out for yourself, go to the Stafford County Museum or find a link to their website at kpts.org. Thank you so much for watching Positively Kansas. Hopefully we've managed to brighten your day with what's so wonderful about our great state. Brought to you by Central Security Group, your experts in home automation, security, and peace of mind. View video on your smartphone and control your home's lights, locks, heating, cooling, and more. Security app compatible with Apple Watch and Amazon Echo.
The preceding program was brought to you by TZ Productions, offering 40 years of media experience.